a certain suite of conditions that really hits you hard. So you've got pain, depression, anxiety. You've got Parkinson's disease, because it's where the dopamine has a huge physical response. You've got a few autoimmune diseases, sometimes asthma. Oh, and addiction. There's a whole question about addiction. But what happens is in those, so when you often see there's a dubious sort of form of healing out there, they'll say, like, it can cure pain, it can cure anything from depression, pain, even Parkinson's disease. Those might seem like three very disparate things, but in fact, they're all linked by strong placebo responses. And if you guys are trying to create, like, next blockbuster pseudo drug, you know, that's where you want to focus. You want to focus in obsessive-compulsive disorder. Does not respect well, respond well to placebos. And you do not want to focus on, well, autism doesn't, but what's interesting is the parents of autistic children often see placebo effects in their children. But autism itself doesn't respond well, does not respond well. Alzheimer's disease does not respond well to placebos. It's just not, the chemicals involved aren't things your brain has access to. So that's the most interesting about this, is there's some, you see these effects in some conditions, but not in others. The sad one for me is always cancer, because cancer, the symptoms of cancer respond very well to placebos. So I can give you something, tell you a good story, and have all your symptoms go away. The pain, nausea is another one. But the tumor does not. The tumor does not respond well to placebos. And so I talked to a lot of patients who spent a lot of money on false cures, hoping to cure their cancer, and what they got was relief from their symptoms for a while, and then they went back to Dr. Wurzhov. Steve Jobs is the most famous person who, it's just not a great thing. You know, I don't have any problem with treating your arthritis with placebos. Don't treat cancer with placebos. But Parkinson's is a great thing to treat with placebos. It turns out, take no grain of salt. At least it's a transition, because I want to talk about a subject I wrote about, who found out that he had early onset Parkinson's at 30 years old. He was 41, something like that. And just crushing news. He spent the next 8 years sort of, going downhill, really having a hard time managing his treatment, and looking for some way to get out of this. And you know, his son was growing up, a little kid, and he wanted to, watch his son grow up, and it had been, after many years anyway, he eventually found, he got himself, his doctor, Captain Kristen, got him signed up for a new drug, a new therapeutic drug, that basically got drilled into his skull in two places, and injected this drug called Neurontin into the substantia nigra, the deep inside his brain, in order to sort of kickstart the part of his brain that produces dopamine back into the operation. And so he goes in, and because these Parkinson's treatments over the years have had so many problems with placebo, so many false starts, that whenever they do an operation or an experimental operation with Parkinson's, they have to do a sham surgery, which means they have to do a fake surgery, which basically they just carve a couple pins in your head and then leave it, don't do anything else. And so it feels like you got an operation, but you didn't. You didn't actually have the job. Anyway, after the procedure, his life turns around. I mean, his life, he goes hiking. He's able to, he actually climbed Half Dome, the backside of Half Dome. He did a half marathon. He went heli skiing at one point. Like, this just changed his life. Parkinson's, the best that they're trying to do is basically to halt it, halt the progression of Parkinson's. That's what all research is going to do. And his Parkinson's went backwards. That's unheard of. It doesn't happen. It's actually impossible. As much as anything's impossible. And he was amazed. And Kathleen Kirsten, who's on the research team, was like, we cured Parkinson's. Like, this is it. And the second time they're trying to do this, like, the company was really leveraged to the hilt. But so they needed this to work. So after they did a longer trial than ever done before, it was 2 years long. And at the end of it, they all researched together and they said, it failed. The treatment failed because the placebo response was so high that all of these people who got better were not able to outperform the people who had placebo responses. And she was crushed. I mean, this miracle treatment was not going to be available. Like, this woman spent her life working on Parkinson's disease. Like, this is not going to be available. The company actually went out of business. Got to talk to someone else, and they're kind of floating out there somewhere. And so she went back to tell her patient. But before she did, his name was Mike. First of all, she unblinded the study to see who got what. Mike got the placebo. He didn't get the procedure. He didn't get the fake one. He's the reason why it didn't work. Or people think the reason it didn't work. And so, we're often saying, oh, it's just a placebo. Well, yes, it's a placebo, but just, I don't know if just is the right word, because placebos can be very powerful. We wouldn't have been using them for thousands of years if they weren't powerful.
Is he still doing well?
He's doing well. Yes, that's a good question, because how many of you guys would have told him? anyone have told him?
Possibly
misdiagnosed
or
whatever. He was definitely misdiagnosed. He was really onset. I mean, he has all the information, and yet you guys wouldn't tell him that information.
Well,
that's a great question. This is where you start getting individual choice. I talked to him a long time. And, his doctor said, like, she talked about, like, exactly how she was going to tell him, and, like, getting out to the key, like, what you want to say. He didn't remember any of that. All I remember was she said, placebo group. Like, everything else just, like, went away, and he felt like he got punched in the stomach. In my opinion, I think at that point, you have a choice. There's two ways you can go about this. You can do what I would do, which would be crawl outside of a bottle and just live the rest of your life. And the other thing is, he said, look, because I did this to myself, I can keep doing this to myself. So he was empowered by it after the shock. But I think he can go either way, depending on your personality. And I think he really made a very admirable choice in how he decided to do it. So he's doing great. I had dinner with him a little while back. I saw his son just last week in California, and he's doing really well. And certainly better than he was before the therapy. And the nice thing about that is, if you get a placebo, you're able to do new trials right away. And that's really big in the Parkinson's community, is you can do a trial. So if you got the treatment, you could go into another trial. So like I said, this stuff didn't work. We've been doing for thousands of years. And some of the earliest medicine is clearly, that the teachers were saying, clearly, utilizing placebo. And obviously before that, one can only imagine. And some of the, in my book, I get into some of the history and the early he was trying to create, like, what is real medicine. Even Hippocrates, like, his big thing was do no harm, which was essentially the body can do a lot. Let's not throw a bunch of weird things and sacrifice people to the gods in order to, keep healing. Let's just see what the body can do, which is, it's not a sort of placebo, but it was Avicenna later who really sort of started, he came up with, like, the ground rules of medicine. He's the one who said, what he said, a couple things. First of all, watch out for fake responses, which are placebos. And if you're going to do an experiment, if you're going to try a drug, use it on either a horse or a lion before you tell people. Which is, like, solid advice, right? You have a lion around. Doctors love that, man. You can catch it. Try to lie on our back and then see how it works. I'll give it to you if it works. So there's still a lot of different ways. The photographer and I had a lot of fun. So we're going and looking at different ways that people use belief, expectation, they use the theater of medicine in order to bring healing to people. And what's interesting, why I say this brings together skeptics and the non-skeptics is because these techniques work. They just don't work for the reasons that you're told. If you think about homeopathy says what like cures like, right? So you think, someone's having an issue related to cold, somebody gives them the cold, and that will, heal them. Then you go to traditional Chinese medicine, which says, unlike it cures like. So if you're having an issue related to cold, you can get something warm for the person. Now, those two systems of thinking cannot work together. And so they can't work together, but what they share is the placebo effect. And I found, if you talk to a lot of different healers, and I've talked to you all over the world, when you talk about the things that they can heal the best, they tend to give you a list of pain, depression, anxiety, some ends up with Parkinson's disease, and they give you a list of these great placebo-responding conditions. Speaking of pain, we all think that we're so much cleverer than traditional beliefs. Use modern medicine, that's going to somehow be less to see in the world of placebo. But the placebo controlled trial was in 1962, which was made in the law. We had to, I think it was 62. When was Kennedy shot? It was, yes, 63. So I think it was 62. There was a guy by the name of Lou Lasagna. That was his real name. And the Kepfer, Estes Kepfer? Estes Kepfer. Yeah, the most unpopular man in I think what it was called. He was in the House of creating the bill that allowed the placebo controlled trial, which we all think in order for drug to be sold on the market, it has to be placebo. But what I'm concerned is, and they went through a project with Desi where they removed all of the different drugs that people have been using for a long time that could not meet this new standard. They got rid of 1,000 drugs, which back then was a lot. I think it was a fifth or something like that. All the drugs had turned out the window. They've been using it for, over 100 years. Didn't work. So we think we're lonely somehow. This is a type of surgery in which you actually cement two vertebrae together for specific kinds of back problems. This is a doctor of Wisconsin who's pioneered this surgery. The surgery does not outperform the placebo. Still not, because surgeries aren't like drugs. They don't have to outperform placebos. There's no law that says they do. Same with equipment. Like equipment does not often get compared against placebo. So we're very comfortable with the fact that, first of all, the placebo effect is really high, so it's a hard bar to get over. Second of all, he's making people better. So it doesn't matter that it's a placebo effect. He honestly believes that the surgery is doing something, but if it doesn't outperform the placebo, by definition, it's kind of a placebo. It's very hard to make that distinction. So this is not something that necessarily we are immune to, at least in our Western civilization or Western medicine. It's a huge part of creating drugs and of getting treatments. And it's something that I think a lot of doctors forget about, especially surgeons, whose bedside manner can, often use a little bit of work. I mean, you're throwing away all that great placebo response. And this guy knows his way around bedside manner. This is his treatment. Blow smoke up a really blowing smoke. For him, it's a lot about the relationship and the conversation and the tradition. These are very powerful things, and they're very hard to separate. One of the great studies that's come out recently has looked at the social, the peer pressure element of placebos. Okay, so this is an interesting study they did. So they brought companies together. The first one, I love, is in Colorado, and they did this experiment. And kind of like an idea, we're like, okay, we're gonna do different things, and we're gonna, you're gonna tell us how much pain you're in, right? But there's one little side thing that said, just so you know, this next one, we're in pain. 50 people said it didn't hurt that much. Be honest, tell us if it hurts. But just know that like 50 people said it didn't hurt. But that's true. Sure, I don't know which one wrote me. The next time around, they say no, there's no one. Just everyone else said this really hurt. Be honest. But just know that no one else thought this was easy. Like, oh, that really hurt. And of course, pain. But it's way beyond what you see as a normal placebo response. And what we found is that like, the social nature of humans has a huge effect on how we respond to placebos. And those people aren't even real. I mean, there was Marks on the screen. There were 50 people. And this is something that the science made up. And they've actually tracked down a couple of the drugs involved. It's vasopressin and oxytocin. Vasopressin, oddly enough, I think it's for women, and oxytocin is more effective for men in terms of creating placebo responses. But there have been experiments. And one has done some of those where she just gave them vasopressin and created a placebo response. And the placebo rates went up through the roof. So those are two chemicals you can give around other people. Oxytocin is famous, like the one you release when you're with your baby. But those are both social hormones, drugs that your body releases when it's around other people. In effect, the details of those cases don't want to go beyond what we know, but they're definitely related to social interactions. And so they basically isolate the chemical that causes these effects. And if you see how these things are used in the wild among people, you get them together, people lay their hands, you get them on top of the same language, and the same